ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and friends beyond the binary. It's time for the podcaster who ain't singing, but believe me, he's bringing the lulls. It's time for Sleep With Me, the podcast that puts you to sleep. And if I could just have your attention for a few minutes while I talk about some of the ways we're able to bring you this podcast. Sleep With Me is also made possible with the hard work of Chris Posterson from Sounds Like an Earful Studios, who edits some of our episodes and does the theme music, Carl W., who edits episodes, Jonathan Mann is on our lullabies, Kenny, Scotty, Jennifer, on our artwork. I'm at Dear Scooter on Twitter. You know, you can listen to the podcast in your smart speakers. You just say, hey, smart speaker, play Sleep With Me podcast on TuneIn. And then you say, set the timer for this long, or you could leave it playing all night. I also want to thank the moderators of the listeners' own Facebook group are keeping people comfort all night long. Keith and Laura, Julie and Jennifer, Sarah and Stacy. And that's it. Let's get on with the show. Hey, are you up all night tossing, turning, mind racing, trouble getting to sleep, trouble staying asleep? Well, welcome. This is Sleep With Me, the podcast that puts you to sleep. We do with a bedtime story. All you need to do is get in bed, turn out the lights, and press play. I'm going to do the rest. What I'm going to attempt to do is create a safe place where you can set aside whatever's keeping you awake. Whether it's thoughts, feelings, physical sensations, changes in temperature, weather, routine, you're on a plane, you're on a train, or you're doing one of those things that someone's trying to say, hey, eat some green eggs and ham or whatever. You say, well, no, I'd rather just unwind and put my headphones on. Whatever it is, I'm here to help you. The way I'm going to do it, oh, I think I already said that. I'm going to try to create a safe place where you can set aside whatever's keeping you awake, any of those things. And the way I'm going to create a safe place is I'm going to obviously try to earn your trust. It usually takes, I'll be honest, it takes a while for me to earn your trust. Because especially, who wouldn't be skeptical about a podcast to put you to sleep? Or am I right? Or am I right, new listeners? So I'm really going to, I don't know if you can hear it. Every few intros now, I try to smooth this safe place out. I'm unable to do that with my bedding. Even though, like, there's nothing better than that when you put on new bedding, you say, whew, it just smoothed that out. So I'm going to try to do that with a safe place. You say, wait, it was smoothed out and a safe place. And what I'm going to do is send my voice across the deep, dark night. I'm going to use the lulling, soothing, creaky, dulcet tones, or croaky, dulcet tones. Those were the frogs that lived in, there's a story, the frogs that lived in Dawson's Creek. They had croaky Dawson tones. That's a show from a while ago. Pointless meanders, you say, the time expired me. I also have expired meanders. I think, well, maybe we could talk about one of those two things. I don't know what I would talk about Dawson's Creek. I had a CRUSH on that. Also aspiration. I think I was aspirationally, I said, well, I'm sure their lives are superior. Anyway, let me get to the, let's see, where were we? I'm going to send my voice across the deep, dark night. Creaky dulcet or croaky Dawson tones, tangents, expired meanders, all those things. I'm going to try to be your friend, your boyfriend, your companion. To be here at your bedside, across the room, across the nation, across the globe, but nearby, as near as you need me or would like me. And then you say, well, how about another 2 minutes? I say, yeah, but just go ahead. You can move your phone. You could lower the volume. I could slow it down and take a little breath here. But I'm here to help. That's the main thing. So if you're new, let me give you the structure show. Podcast starts off with a few minutes of business. That's how we keep the show and all of the archives free, is the business at the top of the show in between the intro and the story. You can find all about that at sleepwithmepodcast.com/sponsors when your hand hits the fridge tomorrow. So thank you for sticking through that. So if you're new, that's how we keep the show going. Then we have an intro, which is around 12 to 14. Sometimes it's gone as high as 17. I'm sure it's been higher. It's been lower, I think 11 minutes. But the intro is a show within a show. Or I don't think it's really the first act, because most people say if that's your intro, maybe it should be your final act. It's not a finale. Your last act. And I'd say, well, it is for some listeners. It's the last act they hear. So thanks for trying to, thanks for that great accidental segue. But yeah, it's a way to get ready for bed, to start the wind down, to start the relaxation, to put your sleep socks on or take your day socks off, to do any bombing or calling of the pets. To do any bombing or, you know, getting your pets in bed or, you know, getting them settled. You know, I'll tell you, I'll do that, like how I get Koa settled most nights, if I can remember any of that. But it's part of the listener's wind down routine. And some people fall asleep during it. A lot of listeners, they get ready, they wind down, they brush their teeth even. But so that's how the intro works introduces the show. A little different every time, but pieces of it are so familiar that you feel like, oh, this is that safe place. It's been padded, it's been rubbed, it's been smoothed down. It's a safe place. And all the expired meanders have been put outside to be picked up by Meander Man, which is Scoots. A bit like the Tooth Fairy with expired meanders, but he doesn't leave any coins behind, except for the ones that fall out of his pocket when he's crawling around on the floor. But what am I talking about? So that's the intro. If you're new, so that's the structure. Intro, then we'll have a bedtime story, and then we'll have some thank yous at the end. So that's how the show goes. Let's see. Where was it? Oh, so that's a structure show. Here's the other things you need to know if you're new. You don't need to listen to me. You can kind of listen. You can reflectively listen and let me just bounce off your ears. Or you can closely listen, whatever you need. And you're also under no pressure to fall asleep. I'll be here for an hour. You can put show after show after show if you need to. And I'll be here all the way to the end. If you can't fall asleep, I'm here for you to keep you company. But otherwise, you got plenty of time to fall asleep and you don't need to listen. A show, ideally, would be just distracting enough that you're kind of listening. And you're saying, I wonder how Scoots does get his dog ready for bedtime. And I say, oh boy, just wait another few minutes and you'll find out. And then you drift off, you know, drift off at your leisure. And so, okay, so I teased how I got get Koa ready for bed. And let's see, I think the whole Pavlovian thing was done with dogs, but I'm not exactly sure. But I do know when I start brushing my teeth, and I don't know if you're a dentist, please don't respond to this, but I usually go mouthwash, floss, and then brush. And I'm positive that's probably out of order, but oh well. I guess, I don't know, but, and as soon as I start brushing my teeth, that's when Koa decides, hey, I'm going to make my last trip outside. So I usually open the door and then she goes outside. I'm brushing my teeth. I go back inside, finish up brushing my teeth. Either she comes back in or she has her own routine that she does out there, which I kind of observe. Where she kind of just walks around and looks at stuff. I think she's just checking everything. And so then if I do have time, if she's really involved out there with walking around and doing her business, then I'll try to stand outside and meditate for a few minutes and listen to the sounds of maybe the BART or the traffic, or notice the fog or the clouds or the moon. And then we'll go back inside, and then I'll close, like, Koa has a chair that's her chair. It has been, I don't know, for 6 years now, I guess. And that's where she hangs most of her time. She does have other beds, but she seems to prefer this chair. And it's right up against one of the, like, windows that's closed, but I'll draw the blinds. And then she likes to have the, like, I guess only in the winter months, or the winter, the fall, and the, like, early spring, I have an old bed sheet. It just happens to be Obi-Wan Kenobi brown, the brown of Obi-Wan Kenobi's cloak. So then I'll put this sheet on her. I actually have two sheets, because then I can wash one, the fitted sheet and the flat sheet. Dogs don't know the difference, believe me. But then I'll, like, actually, like, kind of, I don't really swaddle her, but I put the sheet over her and I kind of tuck her in, just like you would tuck in a child. And I like to put it overhead. This is every single night, and make her look like Obi-Wan. I call her Puppy Wan, Kenobi. And she kind of looks at me and is like, are you going to also pet me? So then sometimes I'll pet her, like, over the sheet or under the sheet, but I get her all tucked in, snug as a bug. And she seems to like that. It seems to be like, okay, that's your bedtime. And then she gives me those long, like, aren't you going to stay here for 45 minutes and pet me? And, you know, I'm an enabler. So sometimes I say, okay, yeah, maybe I will. But, you know, no, a little while longer. And then I'll head off to do my own routine. But that's kind of Koa's bedtime routine, how I prep her. And ideally, she waits till I'm concentrating on something, and then she'll fall right asleep and start snoring, or just keep staring at me and say, hey, get back over here. Give me some more pets. Also, Ko is my dog, just in case there's any confusion about any of that. I want to clear that up. So that's how I get my dog ready for bed, a bit like the podcast. The podcast, for a lot of people, is part of their bedtime habit, and for a lot of things, that's a good thing. For a lot of people, that's a good thing. They talk about bedtime hygiene and all that stuff. It gets high pressure. But the nice thing about having some kind of bedtime routine is if you stick with it for a while, then it becomes less optional. You're like, okay, this is just what I do as I get ready for bed. Let's just use it like a neutral example. Like, I don't know if flossing actually is neutral, but something you're supposed to do. And so I just don't give myself an option. So now that's what I do. I have my order. If I don't have mouthwash, then I'm totally then I say, oh boy, how am I going to get through the night? So having the podcast, you say, okay, I'm going to get ready for bed, as Scoot said during the intro. You know, listen to everything, and then you turn out the lights and press. I've already pressed. You know what I mean. Okay, that's part of my bedtime routine, part of my wind down, a little ritual. And I guess I was using the, what is that called? An example of Koa's ritual of getting her ready for bed. So, so ideally this podcast, if you're new, will become part of your ritual. It doesn't have to right away, though, because it doesn't work for everybody. It takes a few tries to get used to. Just heard from my friend James, and he said it took him 4 times, and he's met me in person, and he said, yeah, it took four. He liked the show, but he said it took 4 times, and then I started falling asleep. So, big shout out to James. Over at T Public. If you're skeptical, I think that's what I was saying at the beginning. Why wouldn't you be? It's a podcast where someone talks you to sleep. It's a little bit different, a little bit strange, a little bit silly. And I can remember even one time one of my brothers was staying over at my apartment, and he was sleeping on the couch, and he saw me tucking Ko in for bed, and he gave me one of those looks like, oh boy, you haven't changed. You're still as strange as, you're still an odd bird talking your dog. And he was cracking up, but then he was also appreciating how much Ko appreciated being tucked into bed. And it's not strange. I mean, let me tell you, it's not strange. It's delightful for Ko, and it's a used sheet. So it's not like I'm using come on now. So anyway, however you get ready for bed, however you get into bed, I'd like to help. If you've never listened before, I've been there, sleepless, tossing and turning. That's why I make this show. And that's why I work very hard, and I strive and I yearn, because I really, really want to help you fall asleep. Thanks again for coming by. All right, everybody, it's time for kind of a random Tuesday trending style episode. And this one is going to be more of a, what do you call that? a seminar, possibly. Well, I don't know what it's going to be. The general idea, though, is that I'm giving a talk, which I'll have already given by the time this episode comes out, about something. And I said, well, this would actually make a pretty good podcast episode, especially because some of the things I can't give in the talk that it made me think of when I was writing the talk. So, yeah, I'm going to turn it over to the Scoots that does seminars, and we'll go from there. Thanks for listening. Yes, hello, come on in. Welcome. Good to see you. Everyone get comfortable here. And thanks for attending, and we'll be taking, you know, you could, we'll be talking. This is a free seminar, of course, and I'm Brad Bradderson from the Boredom Institute. You might remember us from such amazing seminars as Bore to Win, Bore Your Way to Health, Wealth, and Happiness, and Fitness. Oh, that was in Health. We did change that one. And we gave one about something about banter. We've done a lot of things here at the Banter Institute, and tonight we're doing something a little bit different because we're, you see, a little bit of backstory behind the Banter Institute. The Banter Institute over the Boredom Institute, also the we have both of those, Banter Institute, and they're under the same umbrella organization. And that's where Pickle comes into the equation, because the umbrella organization we're organized under giant quotes, when we say organized, it turns out, now none of us knew this, we'd been working hard for years developing techniques that could be monetized about a board, you know, to bring health, wealth, and happiness to purchasers of our courses and through boredom and boredom-related techniques. And all of us have been here toiling away, chasing our dreams and living our lives, so we thought, and hoping we'd hit the big boredom jackpot and find a course we could sell for $8,000 or $9,000, you know, to 10 or 20 people a month. And, you know, we were like, should it end in 97 cents or 98,993 or 8,999 or 999? You know, should we start doing those video things where you just talk, video conferences or whatever they're called? How could we work real estate? What are the trends and how could we capitalize on those things? You know, capitalize to help and even exchange. First a free course and then thousands of dollars. That was the vision here, both the Boredom Institute and the Banter Institute. And we were recently learned that we all are under an umbrella organization called Scooter's Brain. And it turns out that we exist. Now, this is just, now we would call this, you know, we what hashtag we would use about this news we received. But we really, we said, we believe, the earth is round. We don't know what you're talking about. You're telling me I exist within the brain of someone named Scooter. I don't buy it, and I don't subscribe to that as my reality. And that was my supervisor, Karen. She said, listen up, my supervisor, Taitha, had passed down that we have to follow these. This is what we've heard, and this is what's coming. And you can believe whatever you want. That's what they told me. So that's why I'm not, I'm totally calm. And, this is just an organizational situation that we may or may, we said we could, we could reorganize, we could redistribute. And also Karen and Taitha had sat down with me recently and said, listen, Brad Bradderson, they called me Mr. Bradderson. Unfortunately, I knew that. They said, we haven't sold any of these courses. We haven't monetized boredom. And while there are lots of people out there using boredom techniques to get good rest for health, wealth, and happiness, we haven't moved in any $8,000 courses or anything, really anything else. So the rubber's about to hit the road. And I said, what about that banter? What about the Banter Institute? How are the numbers looking over there? They said, not great. And they said the carrier of the umbrella called. And then they explained to me the whole situation. And they said he'd like to come on and do a seminar. And I said, well, we're all here in a seminar room, you know, that we, you know, did get this community college to let us use for free, because this is a free course, an introductory course. Well, usually, I don't know exactly what this gentleman's going to be talking about, but it is a scooter, and he, I guess, apparently is the carrier of the umbrella, which our organization is organized under. And so with that, I'm turning it over to Scooter, which will be, this will be, oh, thank you. Thanks for turning that over to me, Brad. Great job. Brad Bradderson, everyone, the visionary. Yeah, you see that, Brad? I can pump you up. The visionary behind such courses as Bore Your Way to Health, Wealth, and Happiness, Bore to Win. I like that title, Brad. And the seven stages of banter, and using banter to go to health, wealth, and happiness. Easy money through boredom. Brad, that was a pamphlet you worked on, right? That was a good one. Yeah, believe me, Brad, I'm familiar with your work. I may carry the umbrella, but I'm also part of the umbrella. Sit down and think about that, Brad. Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, friends beyond the binary, guests, distinguished guests, which all of you are distinguished yourselves by being there or being here, in you, because let's just be honest, Brad, there's just you and our one guest here. Thank you for coming to this very special seminar where I'm going to talk about marketing, UM marketing, which is, you know, the title we haven't settled on. Being a super fan, marketing. And I'm glad you're here to listen to this, because I'm really going to, as Brad has set the example, Brad has set the pace here for these seminars. I'm really going to try to shine in Brad's shadow, not outshine Brad, but to, you know, be tune into my inner Brad. Which, Brad, by the way, that's strange too, because you are my inner Brad. Though I don't feel like we're in touch, but you're going to learn about a lot about me tonight, Brad. And you might be sitting there and you say, Scooter, you got a cardboard box there. You don't have a slide deck. You don't have a computer. We already know your writing's indecipherable. What kind of knowledge are you going to lay on us tonight? Well, you may be saying, what's unmarketing? Being a super fan. And I'll tell you, you might be sitting there and you may have a podcast, you may not. In all likelihood, you don't. You might have something you're interested in. You might have a business. You might work for a business. Whatever it is, there might be something in your life you're wanting more of. It may be health, wealth, or happiness, as Brad likes, you know, no offense, Brad, as you assume sometimes. But it might be something else, you know, it might be something deeper. It might be a yearning you can't quite put your finger on. But whatever it is, this unmarketing, being a super fan, will help you. And I'm going to explain the easy steps to being a super fan. And then talk about the reasons why being a super fan will help you in Brad's case. Actually, Brad, do you want health, wealth, and happiness? Or do you want the happiness you think health and wealth will bring you? Also, isn't there usually great, how about some great posture? Because you do have pretty good posture, Brad. And an older brother tells me, JP's big on that posture. He says, put your shoulders back. So think about that for a second, Brad. If that's something you want, I can work on getting you that tonight. And actually, Brad, do you mind if I use you as an example? Because you're the only other person in the room other than our guest here. Thank you again for coming, and I hope you're comfortable there. You're really giving me some good attention. Thank you so much. And where was I? I was talking about marketing. Or just being a fan, being a super fan. We'll get into all that. But you might be saying to yourself, especially if you're a podcaster, because that's what I do. when I'm not holding the umbrella for Brad and the rest of the team. And so with a podcast, so let me explain to you a little bit of it, since it just, I'm going to go and assume you aren't a podcaster. You're giving me a smile and a nod. Thank you. One of the big concerns for all podcasters is how do we grow our audience? How do you get more people to listen to your podcast? And there's a lot of other concerns, and actually Scoots here, I do share that concern with a lot of podcasters, but a lot of podcasters say, hey, how'd you get that audience you got there, Scoots? What kind of magic did you have in that old podcast hat you found? And I said, well, just the dull, you know, just I bored to win. And I tell them it's not magic, actually. It's a combination of... And it's usually I go on a boring tangent. Say, well, mostly it's a lot of hard work. When opportunities come up, that's great. And just being nice. And normally they don't really take that answer seriously because they say, well, it can't possibly be. And I say, okay, well, I don't know then. A lot of this is growing your audience. And even as I've learned about making a show financially sustainable, it's a lot of it's out of your control, and that can be really hard. And I guess when you think about the broader picture, a lot of things are out of our control as humans or as a part of an umbrella team like Brad here. And Jay Pete may tell Brad that his posture is under his control, or their control, Brad. But I would say, well, maybe you could eventually get your posture under your control, but a lot of the day, your posture is just doing its own thing. So that's probably a bad metaphor or simile to make right now. But there's a lot of things in our life that we can control, and there's some things we can't, and there's some things we feel like we have control over, and we don't necessarily do. And I've steered way off topic to say, the reason I designed this seminar free, it's actually not a seminar because I don't even know, to be honest, Brad, I don't know what seminar means. Is the seminar a series of talks or a talk with breaks in between it? So this is just a talk and it's something anybody can implement. It's pretty much free and it spans anything, more or less, Brad. But I believe it's the most effective way to grow an audience, one of the more effective ways. It can, now, Brad, with other team skills like you have of coming up with titles for seminars or other ideas, this can run independent and parallel to any other efforts you're putting forth. But I want to present myself not as an expert, and I may be suffering from the, I don't think fallitude's a word, but in this case, it might be a fake word that fits the fallitude. Oh, I think it's maybe fallacy. Thank you. Thank you for being in the audience tonight. Looking back of a process versus results, right? But I think that would be more of something someone would say to say, well, that idea won't work. So I'm going to use the fallacy of fallacies to dismiss your idea as ineffective. And I was going to say, I'm also not an expert on marketing or advertising, but I did want to say a few differences I wanted to point out right here in marketing, advertising, and also social media. So I view advertising as paid ads, paid advertisements, it would say, to people that don't listen to your podcast in this example, or don't purchase your seminar, much like a Facebook ad says, hey, come on, check out Brad's seminar, bore to win. And it might have a video or it might have some, you know, moving things. And it might say, hey, click here and you can learn more. Now, marketing, I don't really understand that what that is either. I think that's like all the other things other than advertising to bring an audience. In this case, advertising or marketing are efforts you're putting forth or money you're putting forth to bring new listeners to your show. If you have a store, it might be to bring more customers into your store. If you have a restaurant, to more patrons. If you cut hair, more people to get their hair cut, or at least come by and say, hey, tell me about how you cut hair because I have fur. So those are advertising and marketing. There are things and terms I'm familiar with, but don't totally get. Now, there's also social media, which people say, oh, social media marketing. And I'm just going to use the example of a sleep podcaster or someone that does boredom seminars, is to say people that choose to follow the Boredom Institute or the Banter Institute or listen to the Bantercast, everyone's favorite podcast about banter and things interesting to banterers, or Script Notes, which is kind of not about, I guess they do banter a little bit on Script Notes. Script Notes, also Scrib Notes, that's everyone's favorite podcast about scribbling notes and things interesting to scribblers. And that's actually a good show because they just bring in people, you know, that just don't scribble notes. They might be a scribbling artist. One of my favorite episodes was the code-breaking one where they brought in somebody that scribbled code. And, oh, too bad those podcasts, they also exist only under the umbrella, same umbrella that Brad exists under. It's a wide umbrella, though, Brad. Don't worry. But, yeah, let's say you're running the Script Notes podcast or the Banter Cast. And you say, oh, shucks, I'd like more people to listen to this. You could use advertising or marketing techniques, and there's a lot of them out there, free. And then especially for a podcast like a Banter Cast or a scribbling podcast, there may be paid options. And I would say pretty much check your ROI 10,000 times because, as we know, in the podcast world, it can be tough to, you want to make sure things are sustainable and that the money's going out, it has a guaranteed, near guaranteed ROI, or at least like a return on investment. So if you were, for example, looking for new listeners through ad, Brad, for the Banter Cast, you'd say, okay, well, the ad is $100. Okay, well, you would say, well, I'm trying to grow my audience. How many listeners am I going to get for $100? And they say, well, this many. But I say, hold on, Brad. Whose $100 are you using? Because you also have to think about, well, how many listeners is it going to bring in? And what are the tiny percentages where you could turn get that $100 back or $105? So you have to know, Brad, well, if there's a, what is it? Let's say that Bantercast has 100 listeners. Now, all of those 100 listeners every month in this world, but this may be accurate, generates you a half cent, maybe. What is it? So 50 cents you're making, I think, for your 100 listeners. So if you're spending $100, you would have to do the math to say, okay, how many listeners would I need if I make a half cent per 50 cents per 100 per, and that might not even be, Brad, here's the thing, that might not even be per month. I'd have to look. That might be a yearly number, and that might just be your revenue, Brad. Maybe it's that would be your monthly revenue. That's not even... So those are numbers you have to, I guess, before you spend any money, better think twice, I guess, was what I was saying, Brad. And then I went on a little tangent there. So we'll avoid talking dollars and cents, so Brad, from here on out. So there's social media marketing and social media advertising, but Brad already has some followers on the old Bantercast. But those are people that are interested in Brad, that are interested in banter and interested in people bantering about banter and things interesting to banterers. But most of them are already familiar with Brad and the Bantercast, and most of them are probably regular listeners of the Bantercast or fans of Brad, as we say around here, FOBs, fans of Brad, yeah. And so, Brad, they don't really necessarily, marketing to them, and advertising to them may not be the best idea, best use of your time if you're doing it for free. because it's going to cost you an effort, or if you are investing money, because they already listen to the BanterCast. Maybe you want to alert them, hey, a new episode of the BanterCast is out. Hey, this episode of the BanterCast was sponsored by Scribblecast. Scribblenotes. Or, hey, this is BanterCast has a new sponsor, mouth lube or whatever. It keeps your mouth loose for bantering. So that's more you're using your social media, Brad, to alert your followers, your existing audience to things. I think they call it a call to action sometimes, or to interact. I think that's the most powerful use of those social medias, is just to interact with the people that are interacting and say thank you. Instead of saying, and you might say, hey, whatever the company, isn't that called Chapstick, not mouth lube, or whatever they call it, mouth, what do they call it, lip balm, not mouth lube, or is that something different? Because they could use that. There's like throat coat tea. What about throat coat tea for sponsoring the BanterCast? So that would be a tough one, Brad, I know, because, you'd have to sell a lot of tea just to break even. But I think like a brand lift. It's time for brand lift. So get lip balm on the BanterCast for sure. So do you understand what I'm saying, my guest and Brad? Maybe just start looking at your social media channels, as the talker, the chattering class, as Craig Mason likes to call them. I think he's referring to a different group, but... they say, this new episode out. Use it to interact and to say, hey, this is something. Or, hey, Brad's pretty funny when Brad wants to be. So, Brad, you could, it's going to lead into things. So let's circle back, because I went way off of things. And let's agree for a few things. Advertising and marketing is tough. And if it costs money, it's even tougher. Social media, at least in this case use, and I realize there's other case uses, and also I'm not exactly sure what case use means, but sounds good here. Social media is probably better to alert your audience, or to interact with your audience, or to update your audience, versus market something they already know about too. So telling them, hey, check out my podcast. They say, hey, I already know about it, but hey, thanks for letting me know what's on this episode. That's a little bit different. So then we would say, well, and also Scoot said, but growing your audience is a little bit out of your control. So what do you do then? Holy mackerel, I'm stumped. And that's what our seminar is about. And maybe Brad will be monetizing this seminar. So we'll get right to the point if we're doing it in another situation. And now's when we're going to dig into this box here. And what you're going to see, my guest there, is as I pull out this box, it is a fan. And it is a bedroom size fan it doesn't have the stem holder thing. And you'll soak it in. It's a black plastic fan. So it's been made in the last few years. It's a 3-speed fan. It claims to have some sort of tornado thing, but it's not very big, less than a foot, maybe 10 inches, maybe 6 inches, probably 6 inches. And it's a 3-speed fan. And you say, if you saw this, you'd say, it looks a little bit better than your average fan, but it doesn't oscillate or whatever, turn side to side. And it does go up and down, but where I put it is on my dresser, pointed towards my bed. And this particular fan, this actual fan we have here, and yeah, I can just pass it. There is a little dust on it. I didn't clean it. I've left it in its natural state. But that's my bedroom fan, and I use it almost every night because I like to be freezing cold if possible. I also like the sound of it. And I guess I like that it moves the air. And you could definitely say that I am a fan of this fan. Thanks for laughing, Brad, but it's true. I'm a big-time fan of this fan. And let's use it. This fan is going to be a symbol, of course, but it is a real fan that I want to get that out there, that I'm a fan of, because it does a lot for me. And the times I don't use it, I end up waking up and saying, what in the heck? Or the times I don't put it on. Now, is a fan perfect? No. Because its first speed is its fastest speed. That's my pet peeve with it right there. Because even though I've turned it on 8,000 times, probably, well, not 8,000, but let's say 6 years, a lot of thousands of times. Sometimes I still turn it all the way to what I think would be 3, but is actually 1. And then I get in bed and I say, why the heck am I so warm? And no one in the right mind's warm in your situation. And I say, well, okay. It's because my fan is on 1 instead of 3. So just a little note, nobody's perfect, but nobody's flawed. It just happens to be the way you were built. And while we're talking about that, I could use a 4, I don't know your speeds have enough distance between them. I would like you to be, and this is, the fan can take it. Believe me, I'm a fan of this fan. But I would like a higher top speed. But this fan has worked. It's done its job. It's an effective fan. And I'm a fan of it. And this might be an obscure example to use. But that's what we're going to talk about tonight, is being a fan. And let me get my notes. I know I've been going off my notes without notes. And I don't know what a slide deck is. I'm aware of what they're called. But now we're going to talk about marketing. And what I mean by marketing, or being a super fan, which we're going to refer to it, is just becoming a super fan of things you're already a fan of. And you might say, okay, let's not jump ahead of ourselves. No reason to jump ahead of ourselves. Brad's a fan of boredom and banter. Oh, no, wait a second, Brad. I think we may have a breakthrough. No, I don't know what you here in the audience are a fan of. And if this were interactive, I'd say, what are you a fan of? But that's not that portion of the talk yet. I just get distracted because they said, is Brad a fan of boredom and banter? Or do you see boredom and banter as a means to an end of health, wealth, and happiness, which you're a fan of, Brad? And then I would wonder, are you really a fan of health, wealth, and happiness and posture? I mean, I'm a fan of your posture, Brad. Good looking out, because it's great. Or is there something else you're a fan of? Now, I'm only asking questions here, Brad. I'm not giving answers. But it's just something to think about, Brad, because we're going to talk about going deeper into your fandom, nurturing that inner fandom. And you might say, well, being a fan is just a natural, organic process or processes, Scoots. And Brad might be thinking, how are we going to monetize fandom? And I'd say they're called fan clubs, Brad. I think, it's not, you can't charge $8,999.98 for a fan club. You probably could. There probably is someone selling a course on making fan clubs for health, wealth, and happiness, though, Brad. And they probably have made like $14. But anyway, yes, being a fan is a natural, organic process. But we're going to talk about the way you cultivate that is just to pay more attention to it. We're not going to interrupt the flow or the process of being a fan or of having strong preferences. We're going to give it a little bit more of our attention and try to move deeper into it. Just like Brad helps people move deeper into their dreams, right, Brad, through processes, and just like you're here. Here at this seminar, and maybe you said, what does marketing mean? Is that just because Scoot's got that unlimited minutes from that commercial stuck in his head? And I'd say, correct. And I would tell you, I haven't delved deep enough into my fandom of that ad, because I'm really just a fan of that joke. I think it's a brilliant joke, and I'm not sure who wrote that commercial where they said unlimited minutes, but I would say, I'm a fan of that joke. In reality, I'm a fan of the mind that came up with that joke. I'm sure that it's maybe someone that's ideally achieving success, or it could be some sort of, just marketing guru. I don't know, but I did like that joke. Brad, would it be more bored win if I explain the joke? No, just move on. It was just unlimited minutes instead of unlimited minutes. And the person would say, wait, my phone plan comes with unlimited minutes. They said, no, yeah, unlimited minutes it comes with. Just like doll hairs. Maybe you can make 8,000 doll hairs, Brad. Okay, so we're talking about becoming a deeper fan of the things you're already a fan of, or new things. Like Brad, we could be setting Brad on a course here to say, maybe next week you'll be a chiropractor or a person selling courses on how to sell courses on chiropractory for health, wealth, and happiness. Or maybe you could just be a fan of, maybe you could be the first posture pod. Podcasting about great posture, Brad. How about that? It could be interesting. Okay, so there's just four steps. This is really easy because this is going into the marketing thing. Right away, we're going into it. It's taking your fandom, making it deeper, and then sharing it. And you're going to see very quickly why it's called unmarketing or unmarketing, you could call it, is because you're not marketing anything but the things you're already a fan of. So there's just four steps. There's probably more you could take and probably a more effective way to do it. But I'm going to run through them and then I'm going to explain them. One is noticing. Two is giving voice. Three is sharing it. And four is an and or. Saying thank you. And let me say right up front, Brad and our guest here, I'm not the greatest at this. And I tend to get over harried, which interrupts my fandom. And maybe by putting this out in the world, I'll help foster some more fandom within myself and the appreciation of the fandom. But I inconsistently do this, and I found I've even, it's made my life better just by inconsistently, and I'm constantly inspired by the people that do it on a regular basis. Noticing. Simple noticing is, I love this. Can't wait for the good place. This restaurant has great fries. Or I love this podcast. More noticing. We're already moving into stage two, but it's like, ooh, you're just doing that more often, I would say, internally or externally. Whoa, oh boy. Maybe you could come up with more words. But noticing when that happens and saying, let me give some attention over there. I guess like sleuthing a little bit, sleuthing your inner fan. Maybe, I don't know what McGruff's up to, but maybe I think I saw McGruff on a streaming commercial, but maybe I could get McGruff over here and you could say, McGruff, we need you sleuthing people's inner fandom. Okay, so you're going to go from noticing to giving voice, which is something we're inconsistently taught as children in therapy, in couples therapy, in group therapy. Is like a little bit of an I statement. You could also use techniques like labeling. And you say, well, I don't like to put labels on things. I say, okay, well, you could just say giving voice. You're going to give voice to you're going to go deeper. You're going to go from the, or guffaw, hearty har har, oh boy, or oh dear, like those things. You can say, wait a second, did I just say, And you're going to say, And maybe you'll analyze your somatic responses. What is your body saying? What is your brain saying? What did you just hear, taste, feel, see, or interact with? And you're going to dig deeper and you're going to give it voice. You're going to say, maybe you just label it at first. You say, I felt the thrills when I heard that. When that hit my tongue, it was tangy in a good way, or that resonated with my feelings of resentment. Maybe it's something like that. Who knows? But you're going to try to give voice to it. In the framing of an I statement, sometimes you say, I felt blank when I heard this, when I saw this. And that is a little clinical. So I prefer just giving voice. But if you want a starting point or something that's familiar, you could say these I statements. Now you've given it a voice. And this will be stages. Some of you might already be good at that. This, I'm not. So I may be in Brad, I don't know about you, or I guess here, hello, where you're at. And this is, I guess, a spectrum, and it might be a spectrum of every day as I go off topic again. But it's like, sometimes for me, I just have to say, you know, Scoots, it's okay to be a fan. It's okay to take some time for yourself to do something pleasurable that you enjoy or that you're interested in, like reading Clark's World. That would be something. Or a more neutral example, turning on this fan. So, and then maybe I'm a little bit, I can be numb a little bit at a time or distracted. So noticing, saying, wait a second, did I just get the shivers from something in a good way? Do I have a case of spree fever and I haven't had any spree? Well, what could cause the spree fever? And maybe eventually I'll be better at giving voice to it. And then the next two parts are marketing. That's the marketing. Ooh, I guess you could be ooh marketing, but then it wouldn't reference that joke. Now you're going to share it. You gave voice to it. Now share it with the people that you interact with. It could be just the people in your regular life, Brad. If there's another Brad or Sin or someone that Brad's heart, you know, or just Brad's friends or your friends or people you encounter, you might be at the checkout, you might be bantering, and you might say, well, you know what I love is scribbling, you know, I love scribbling on my grocery list. And, you know, one of the things that makes me feel really good about my scribbling, I used to say, what a wasted time that is, until I started listening to Scrib Notes. And then I realized there's millions of people across the world that enjoy scribbling and that I'm not alone. So share it and then start to share it on social media if you use those things. You don't have to go overboard. You could do it every once in a while. Or if you're like Brad, you're a little more organized, you could set a schedule, Brad. I can't do that, but maybe you can, or maybe you can. You see, this morning I'm going to talk about my favorite podcast or my favorite TV show, the movie I just saw, the dinner I just ate. You're going to pour your fandom into the world and, you know, let it flow out of you. And then also you're going to say thanks when you can, or it's optional. Now, this we'll go into the paradoxical part of this later if we have time. But remember, you may not be heard. It's just like and this may be a good way to practice, just go in a forest and shout it. If no one's, you know, using the forest for solitude that you're aware of, is just shout things. I love this ice cream cone. I love this fan. I mean, you know, that might not resonate with a lot of people. But if I shout it in the forest, it doesn't matter. Or if I pet my fan, which I do, like I'm doing right now. I say, I love this fan. And if this fan was, if this fan wasn't just a simple example, I'd say, hey, you got to check out this fan. If someone, I don't know, I guess it's tough with the example. I'd say, well, what's your favorite fan? I'd say, well, I'm an aspirational fan. You know, I want that like space age fan that the vacuum dude makes. But anyway, don't let my fan hear that, because I'm still a big fan of you anyway. Okay, so let me get back on course. Okay, saying thanks. You could say thanks, and this is a personal example, and it's an old one. And actually, the strangest thing involves the episode of Script Notes. And I've shared it before. I was listening, and there was an episode where John was out of town, and Craig was interviewing Alec Berg. And Alec Berg was talking about making Silicon Valley the TV show with Mike Judge. And they were talking about, well, just when they're making episodes, when they're writing them, when they're directing them, like, how do you know how far to take a joke? Where do you draw the line with your humor or with the humor you're going to release in the episode? Like, how hard do you push jokes to where they're not funny anymore? or, you know, that people might not find them funny. And he gave, he said, well, actually, we have a rule around here in the writer's room or between Alec Berg and Mike Judge. They call it the Wheel of Fortune rule. And he talked about how they just on Wheel of Fortune, if you go over, you're out of the game. So they try to always not go over with the jokes on that show. They try to get it to 99 cents as close as they can, but they try to make sure they're right up against that edge, but not even overlapping and over the edge. And everyone has a different preference. This isn't about a right or wrong way of telling jokes, but that really resonated with me in a different way about making the Sleep With Me podcast. And I said, huh, I'm always trying to figure that out, not in a joke sense, but in some other, a little bit intangible sense of how far am I pushing these things? And it just resonated with me, and I appreciated it, and it made me feel less alone. And then because of social media, I was able to just say, hey, so heard you on Script Notes. Thanks a lot. That meant a lot to me. And that was energy that went out in the world. Maybe some listeners saw it, or they said, wow. And maybe Alec Berg saw it, or maybe Alec Berg didn't see it. That's part of the results part. We don't worry about that with this. You're just putting it out. You're sharing your fandom with the world. We're thanking the people, and you're saying why. I did probably say why. That was back when it was 144 or whatever. But you're just saying why. Now I'm going to run through quick. Why does any of this work? Why is this a good thing? And why would it work if we were using the examples of a podcast, of growing a podcast? So this couldn't possibly, being a fan of something and sharing it, couldn't be possibly work unless you're talking about reciprocity, which we're not, and we'll get to that last. I mean, I can tell you if you just happen to be not like sleeping to this in your podcast, I guarantee this will work 100 times better than whatever you're doing right now. And I'm going to tell you why. But I can tell you, especially doing this for a long time, this will work better than any other. And yes, it's a paradox. And yes, it doesn't make any sense. So I'm going to again tell you why. And the first one is you're kind of, this is a strong phrasing of it, but you're setting an example and you're shouting, just like in the forest of a public, you're saying, hey, I'm a fan of something. And I don't know. I think that builds courage and unity and says, huh, you can use social media to shout and say you're a fan. Now, I don't always practice these things all the time myself. But I'm trying to get better. Then the other thing of setting an example is if you do have a podcast or some sort of social media or a restaurant, you know, people that are already enjoying it don't necessarily, one, know the incredible power of positive word of mouth. There's reactionary word of mouth. And we're talking about a different kind of deeper connected word of mouth that is unbelievably powerful. But a lot of people, one, don't know the power or don't know how to do it. So by doing it, you're also learning how difficult it is. You say, well, I don't like sharing that kind of stuff. It's kind of a hassle. You say, okay, yeah, that's just like what it's like for your followers, your listeners. Sharing that I love this or that you're in town, for example, or this fan, if this fan or fans, bedroom fans in general, well, it takes a lot of work. It's more things to do. Yeah, it is. I grant you that. And then you'll relate to your audience when you ask them to do something. And you also realize that it's kind of counterintuitive. Oh, all you got to do is follow that process. Even though it doesn't sound powerful, it is. Feel it, notice it, label it, share it. Another great thing about it is it's going to make your work better. Seeing people that do something better than you is going to inspire you. It's going to impact your subconscious. You're going to notice things and you're going to learn things and you're not even going to know you're learning things. Another thing is like you're going to really start to harness a persistence and energy via gratitude, which is a tough thing to come by unless you're a really well-adjusted person, which I'm not. But by working hard at something and then seeing people that you, that inspire you or that maybe you aspire to, and hearing their stories of difficult times or of all the time they spent working on something, of all the obstacles that they overcame in their path, and the difficulty and the rarity they had to hone their craft. We could be talking about anything too here, to achieve what they've achieved, to create what they are creating that's inspiring you or making you feel or causing you to emote or physically respond, that it's really never been easy for them. It can make you thankful for where you are and kind of keep you, the carbon in you or whatever you want to call it. You say, wow, it ain't easy. It's not easy for me. It's not easy for them. I'm really grateful for where I am, for the listeners I have. And I'm going to stay dedicated. I'm going to stay on course because they did. Another thing about being a fan is it's authentic, and people are in the world looking for authenticity. And the more naturally authentic you can be, it's going to deepen your connection with yourself. It's going to deepen your connection with the people that share, whether it's just people in your community or it's people that you're whatever trying that consume what you make or potential consumers of it. They may relate to your fandom. They may share your fandom, but you're also being vulnerable. Even when I talk about how much I love this fan, you could hear the vulnerability in my voice of how I know that when I switch it on, it's time for me to get into bed. And I know that I really appreciate that its presence there. And I appreciate that I've taken the time to say, hey, I really like having this fan blowing on me and regulating my temperature. Even though when I'm in the morning, it helps me get out of bed faster because then I'm kind of cold and I want to shut the fan off. When you share deep things about yourself, you do let yourself be vulnerable, but in a very safe way. You're also like participating and putting good things in the world. And that's what we really, really need. And that's what deep down most of us want, Brad included. Behind the health, wealth, and happiness is happiness or a search for it, right, Brad? Of a world where people feel heard, they feel authentic and appreciated and acknowledged, and filling the world with good stuff as opposed to loogies is that's the world most of us want to live in. And one more thing when it comes to podcasting is, like, if you're a podcaster, is we want to grow the pie. We only per smallest percentage of the world, or in the U.S., a quarter of the world, U.S., consumes podcasts on a regular basis. But 100% of the world is fans of something, or maybe they need their needs fostered a little bit more so they can be fans of things. They deserve to be fans of things. And by putting your fandom out in the world, whether it's about podcasts or anything else, and by fostering these connections and appreciations, you're growing the pie. Now, it might be a pie for a radio show, it might be growing the pie for a TV show or a local restaurant or a park or a type of plant. But those eventually are Venn diagrams, and as those circles expand, they will overlap, and then they'll help the other circles to grow. And I just want to close out here. By the way, Brad's asleep, and I see you're doing, I'm glad you're here listening to me. Is I want to talk about reciprocity and Cialdini and the paradoxical nature of this idea, and also acknowledge maybe I don't know what a paradox is, and I haven't read Science, Influence, and Practice in a while. But a lot of times when it comes to marketing, they talk about the theory of reciprocity. If I do something nice for you, you'll do something nice for me. Marketing is not about that at all. And that's not to judge that. That is I think it's a scientifically or psychologically proven thing. But again, that's assuming you could control or you could influence reciprocity. And this isn't a counter or an anti-reciprocity move. It's maybe like a, maybe it could be running parallel if that's what you have to do. But unmarketing is more of an open arms shouting in the forest for the joy of shouting in the forest that you love a fan. A man that loves a fan shouts in the woods about it. I love this fan. I love what it does for me. I'm doing it for the sake of the love of the fan, for the sake of the deeper connection within myself that needs to be exposed. And maybe that it does fall on the ears of the fan, or that I'm injecting the universe or the world or the forest with my shouts of joy. And maybe in the forest example, you say, well, the rabbits really don't like that, or the owls, or the trees, or the people meditate. And I say, okay, well, this is just figurative then. So if you set aside reciprocity, just with the knowledge that, just because this is an opportunity to embrace a paradox. And how often in your life, there's so many paradoxical things, and so many confusing things and so many stressful things. You could say, okay, so I can control the growth of my podcast by not controlling it. Say, well, I'll be honest with you, I don't think it's really under your control anyway. And you may or may not believe that, or maybe it's a very small under your control. But yes, this is a paradox I'm presenting to you. By sharing with what you love, by putting that out in the world, by even maybe by just noticing it within yourself, but ideally by spreading that around. Paradoxically, in some strange way, but I listed the reasons why. But you can't say, well, it's not really a direct connection to bringing me health, wealth, and happiness, good posture. I would say, yes, you're right. It is not an exact connection. It is a paradox. And if you see, I have to use marketing as a word, by marketing other people's things without expecting reciprocity, it will work. And that is a pair. You say, well, it doesn't make any sense, Scoots. And I will say about reciprocity and about doing this, it's not easy. Confronting a paradox, embracing a paradox in itself is, I can embrace this fan. I don't know what a paradoxical fan would look like, but I know how it would look at me paradoxically. But I can embrace the fan. I don't know if I can embrace a paradox. So this is up on the edge of exploration, of adventure in your own life. So it's not easy. And I will say about the reciprocity thing, it is a natural expectation that may generate some resentful feelings. Why didn't that person, they talk about their thing all the time, they don't even acknowledge me or whatever. So you will come up against that. And then again, that's an opportunity for exploration. You say, whoa, those are strong feelings there you have. Interesting. And maybe you even go through a process of saying, you know what, Brad may wake up one day and say, I'm sick of boredom. It's done nothing for me. Hasn't helped my posture, my health, my wealth, or seminars. Maybe that's what Brad's sick of. But maybe then Brad will make that other podcast that I already forgot about not about scribbling or banter, but whatever the other thing was, the Seagull Posture Cast. Maybe the Posture Cast won't be, but maybe you're on a path, Brad, just like that wonderful seminar you did or someone else did about bantering and stepping stones. But really, how often do you get to look a paradox in the face? Except when you're, a dock builder or whatever, you work at a marina. And so that's a little bit about unmarketing and being a fan. I appreciate the Banter Institute and the Boredom Institute and Bantercast and Brad and the whole umbrella team within my mind for having me here. But particularly thank you. Thanks for listening. And I hope you're resting, or I hope you feel the vulnerable connection that I feel with you right now. Thank you so much, really. And good night. All right, I want to say thanks again to the show on Patreon this week and became a patron. Vic, Max, and Julia, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Robin, Kat, and Myra, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Carly, Mary, and Caroline, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Matthew, Devin, and Jess, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Sarah, Callie, and Anna, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Lauren, Alana, Aubrey, Audrey, Moana, and Rosemary, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Sarah, listen, Angela, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Misty, Laura, and Lisa, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Ben, Julie, and Anna, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Rebecca, Sabine, and Susan, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Yvonne, Brittany, and Evelyn, thank you. Thanks, and good night. J.K. Sachs, Ada, and Adam, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Donna, Heidi, and Sharon, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Victor, Vanessa, and Patricia, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Melissa, Rachel, and Samara, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Danielle, Chris, and Jason, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Chloe, Max, and Debbie, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Beth, Rusty, and Nalani, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Logan, Alice, and Joseph, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Michelle, Abby, and Trudy, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Vanessa, Karen, and Kate, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Jean, Amy, and Michael, thanks, and good night. Friendador, Suzette, and Marlo, thank you. Thanks, and good night. Thanks, everybody, for supporting the show on Patreon on a monthly basis. Thank you, and good night.